Bodega, part uno.
Oh. I'm hoping that this is going to be like Gentleman Broncos.
You'll see. All right. Okay.
Can we just interrupt anytime?
Of course,
okay?
No, feel free.
Okay.
As bars go, the Shit Rivet Tavern took sleazy and redefined the word. A trio of spurloopian strippers outnumbered the lone customer, but ground the pole on stage with real menace regardless.
Are you masturbating?
No.
Okay, good.
I was clapping.
I'm not quite there yet. I'm getting close, though.
Behind the chrome-top bar, hunched and moodier than a mork beast, Jargel Floop gazed dully at the tiny vid screen embedded in his left forearm. An empty glass slid down the bar, and with honed reflexes unique to a veteran bartender, Floop caught it, filled it, and returned it with gusto without glancing up. It was the fifth pint of ale the human in the corner had swigged, but it was five times the business Floop had the previous night, so he wasn't complaining. After a spell, the melancholy was broken when the front doors creaked open. Floop saw four figures in desert cloaks, dust masks fastened across their faces, scanning the room from the doorway. Their eyes settled on the human ale swigger at the far end of the bar. They broke formation. Two sat at tables either side of the door. One sat a ways behind the ale swigger, and the fourth approached the bar with all the cockiness of a Krell sluicer. Barkeep, one beverage.
I love the random alien names.
It's insane, right?
It's just like George Lucas 2.0.
Barkeep. One beverage, lady's choice, said the burly interloper, nodding towards one of the spurloopians who was taking a break from swinging her big old titties.
Oh, shit! Out of nowhere!
The spurloopian
titties! Oh, my God! Fuck me.
Give him two fingers of fuck monster, Floop, she slurred.
Oh shit, I'm not ready. I was not prepared.
Floop grinned and poured the black liquor into the traditional phallic drinking vessel and gently pushed it towards the man. Leaning in close, the stranger peeled back his face mask, revealing row after row of razor-sharp off-world combat teeth.
Oh, yes.
He had no way of knowing Floop was odontophobic, so it really was just one of those weird coincidences typical of a space saloon. Put the chompers away, mister. Can't you see my friend here is odontophobic? Said the ale swigger from the corner. Floop looked stunned. How could this guy have known about his odontophobia? Unless... Bodega, said the tooth guy. Said the tooth guy, grimacing. It is you, Bodega, said Floop, turning. He'd not recognized his old compadre and cursed himself for it. Bodega always had money, and he could have charged 5 skrells for the ales instead of 3. Then it dawned on Floop, if Bodega was here and these 4 guys were here, it could only mean one thing. There was about to be one flarve of a good fight.
Oh, man.
You're coming with us, Bodega, like it or not, said Chompers, smiling to show off his fancy gnashes. Floop blinked hard. When he opened his eyes less than a second later, the 4 interlopers lay dead, and Bodega sat finishing the last of his ale. His famous lasgun lay smoking atop the chrome bar. Great moons of Shaboth, you ain't lost your touch, boy, exclaimed Floop. And you're still slower than a glorbworm with the ales, said Bodega, grinning. He played the fight back in his mind. He'd seen the 4 fellows follow him, of course, and had calibrated his lasgun to instantly pierce their Shrovian armor. Just as Chompers had turned to grin at Bodega, he'd taken a shot, refracting the lasgun beam off those shiny dentures to perfectly strike all 3 Goombas right in the heart, killing them instantly. Then, to finish off the leader, he'd simply angled the lasgun beam up off the 3rd incisor in row 5, lower, and turned the leader's brain into Vomanian swamp noodle soup.
Man.
Bodega, said Floop, grinning. Yep, said Bodega, also grinning, but laconically. Bodega, said Floop, still grinning and nodding. Uh-huh, said Bodega. Bodega, said Floop, still grinning. Okay, this was getting weird, so Bodega paid and left. The end.
Oh, magnificent.
Oh, my Lord.
Magnificent P-Flex. That was...
Oh, that was amazing.
Oh, my God.
That was good.
Thank you so much.
Honestly, I could listen to that for hours. Although
I gotta readjust myself.
the amount of aliens that you created, that universe, is so fleshed out already.
Yeah, you know, man, it. You can feel
you know,
it.
Chris Metzen left Blizzard, Flax, and there's an opening for his
get
job. I feel like you could get in there, man. You could be like,
the
you
next
know, the
Chris
next
Metzen,
big thing.
But
like,
with bad yeah. fanfic sci-fi about Bodega.
Oh my,
you know. Gentlemen?
Yeah?
It's time.
It is.
Bodega.
All right, okay. Let me get comfortable. Hang okay. on a second.
We've exhausted all other...
Okay, I got to put my feet up, and I have to recline a bit on my okay. chair and close my eyes okay. as well.
Bodega, part dos. A grey canopy of fog gave way to the brilliant Skirlian dawn. Four suns rising as one, reminding Bodega of the time he almost got run over by a recreational hover vehicle on Platos 4. He slipped his sunglasses into position over his
You're
eyes.
You're like Metzen 2.0, I'm serious. It's crazy.
And squinted down the sights of his las gun back towards his Gretham stealth insertion shuttle. Nobody mooching about nearby, so he felt secure enough in his position. With the sun at his back, he'd learnt this trick in sniper school, where he'd finished top of his class and all the other classes in the history of that sniper school and all other sniper schools. He settled into the loose soil of his hilltop vantage point and checked the las gun pivot bipod once more. The action was as smooth as a slim hound's udder. With the pivot bipod deployed, he'd be able to wreak a terrible revenge on the bastard smugglers down in the valley. There they were now, drinking cups of synth tea and smoking their star vapes. Vaping had been outlawed by the evil Federation director, Krem Slumdump. But those cabrones...
Slumdump!
But those cabrones obviously felt the law didn't extend to them. Bodega laughed to himself. Hell, he loved a good vape too. Bodega wanted to vape really, really badly, but it might give away his position, since he was using an advanced mega vape capable of blanketing a small moon in delicious vape smoke. Enough about vaping, thought Bodega.
Hang on a second. I love the vaping tangent. Oh,
is this,
Bodega.
It's got a little bit of sort of Mary Sue character
No, lots of people vape, Lewis, and as it happens, Bodega happens to use a mega vape capable of blanketing a small moon delicious vape smoke.
I'm delighted to hear
that. That sounds very antisocial, though. I mean, what if the whole moon doesn't want to vape? You know,
enough about vaping,
will.
Thought Bodega. The smugglers were gathered around a collection of small remote-controlled vehicles. Through the vision scope attachment of his las gun, Bodega could practically smell the scum from here. Whatever they planned to do with those RC vehicles, it was going to be related somehow to their smuggling activities, and it was surely going to be a thing a bastard would do. He'd done research on these bastards before he'd taken the mission. Their list of crimes was so long he'd had to take a couple of extra days off just to read through it and get really, really angry. Bodega liked getting really, really angry. It focused his mind, made him sharp, so sharp he'd come up with the idea for the pivot bipod while he was taking a crap. Bodega's famous las gun, known throughout the galaxy as the best of the best of the best in terms of las guns and one of a kind, was capable of a sustained beam which in turn was capable of penetrating the hull of any ship he'd ever shot it at, which was a lot of ships. By definition, a human being in their stupid remote control vehicles was going to be no match. No match at all. He grinned, he being Bodega, and checked the pivot bipod action once more, smoother than a hit from his mega vape. No! No vaping, thought Bodega firmly.
Man.
Down in the valley, the bastard scum smugglers were laughing and joking and starting to fart around with their RC vehicles. There were 10 of them, their hover vehicles parked up in a semicircle. They sure didn't dress like smugglers, the clever bastards. Most of them had glasses on, which was weird, because anybody with 100 skrells could get eye surgery or an implant or something. Maybe it was part of their disguise. Maybe they weren't very good at smuggling and were a bit hard up when it came to cash? Bodega gave it some thought. He couldn't come up with anything. Ah well, 5 minutes till their personal doomsday anyway. What was he, an optician? Bodega checked the action once more on the pivot bipod and instantly thought about vaping. Flav it, he thought, and pulled out his mega vape. He took one huge tug and exhaled, regretting it instantly. The smugglers all looked up towards the 50-meter cubed cloud of vape billowing off the hilltop. One of them fired up and one of them fired up an RC drone and buzzed it straight at Bodega. As it neared him, he tensed every muscle in his body, letting out a small fart as he did so. Not out of fear, but as a precaution. A fart in combat is no joke. It can really put you off. But the drone didn't open fire. It hovered nearby, and a small, reedy voice emitted from a speaker on the front. Hello, are you the park ranger? We have a permit to fly our drones as long as it's not a Sunday. Furthermore, flav this! His position revealed in his cover blown, Bodega started putting some serious heat downrange. Target one was the Pendejo controlling this thing. The famous Lascan of Bodega did its dreadful business and superheated every molecule of water in that dude's body as he exploded into a trillion fiery fragments. Now it was time for the pivot bipod to do its work. No need to take his finger off the trigger. Bodega simply played the Lascan around the smuggler's meeting point like an old man watering some plants. A drop of water for the Grubbles, a dash for the Clearforths, a good soaking for the needy Jup-Jup tree. Although in Bodega's case, this translated into three more smugglers shrieking in agony as they were sliced into bits by the Lascan.
Oh man.
Holy shit.
He took a quick squiz down the sights and noticed that many of the smugglers were crawling around and shrieking. Some had curled up into balls and were crying, and some were more desperately trying to run for cover. Zap! All of them paid the ultimate price for smuggling, which was death by Bodega. Job done. He packed up and headed back towards the Gretham. As he got closer, he noticed a group of men off to the south, close enough to hear their conversation. They wore black stealth suits and each carried a large bore Omni rifle. Hunting season started earlier this year. Bodega gave a cheery wave and a thumbs up. The men looked bemused for a moment before waving back. Bodega climbed into the Gretham and blammed into orbit. Onto his next mission. The end.
Wait, what were they smuggling, though?
Oh, Tips, you didn't get it. They were just flying their drones in the forest.
That was it?
Yes, he killed the wrong people, and then he bumped into the smugglers on the way home.
Oh,
I
shit.
I thought it was obvious. Should I make it more obvious?
It was very obvious.
No, you know
P-flex.
What? It was pretty obvious, but I stopped paying attention because I was thinking really hard about what they were smuggling. Sorry.
You were trying to decipher the puzzle.
I was thinking it because I was like, so the whole time I'm visualizing, right? I'm trying to think about what these guys are smuggling. I realize now that they weren't smuggling, and then, you know, he passed them. But the whole time, I can't get out of my mind how much this reminds me of Gentleman Broncos, you know, like the sci-fi part of Gentleman Broncos.
Yeah,
also,
yeah.
It reminds me a lot of Better Call Saul. You know, when Mike is out in the desert and he's like,
I haven't watched it.
Oh, sorry. That's not a spoiler anyway.
No,
Mike goes into the desert.
No. Mike is in a desert. Point. That's not a surprise.
And he's got a sniper rifle and stuff as well. And it really reminded me of that part of Better Call Saul too. Man, Bodega's really good.
Honestly, P-Flex, that was magnificent.
Tress, are you ready?
Oh, yes.
Get ready. Yeah. Get comfortable.
Hang on. Hold up. Yep, Let me just move the mic down a bit. I'm going to recline a little.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, this time I'm not going to try to think about other shows while you do. I'm going to actually listen and pay attention. Okay, go.
This is reasonably long compared to previous. It's 2 pages.
Oh man, okay, great.
Holy shit.
And you're getting into this. Lewis has got some stiff
competition.
Let
me just sit comfortably.
All right, you ready?
I'm stiff right now though. Yeah.
Oh, me too.
Bodega, part tres, or tray. I don't know how you
tres.
Say it. Bodega peered once more through the quadnoculars. 5 hours he'd been watching the Pulsar Sex Pit, and the only thing suspicious was that he couldn't find anything wrong. This wasn't right. The pit was a legendary hangout for every lad slinger and roid runner in the galaxy. Most of what could loosely be termed his compadres used this very spot to reminisce, catch up, and do business. This time it was different. It was Herc Burke's Burke Day, a very special day for the Burkean people when they celebrated the day they were born. Bodega wondered why, in his experience, humans never celebrated this occasion, but he didn't give a flying crump for it himself.
Flarvin,
he muttered, firing up the tear cycle and zipping down to the pit. He couldn't pass up the chance to see everybody, even if it did feel suspiciously innocent. Too innocent. Like, way too innocent. 100% chance shit was going down here for that very reason. Guaranteed. 100%. Barking up, he ran a quick mental sit rep. Lascan, cocked and loaded, naturally. Jetpack, ready to rock. Scram boots, pumped to the max. Grabby, spring wound tighter than a Spaloopian's love pouch.
Grabby. Hang on a second. Just read that sentence again. Go through this adventure again. One of the comments I did read, P-Flex, was that you need to like take it a little more slowly so you can digest.
Because
it's complicated. When you're reading like a sci-fi...
Do you know what? It's so hard to pay attention to the gobbledygook and the actual story.
Okay. It's not gobbledygook. It's lore. It's lore. Okay. Lascan, cocked and ready, naturally. Jetpack, ready to rock. Scram boots, pumped to the max. Grabby, spring wound tighter than a Spaloopian's love pouch.
Love it.
Shrovian knuckle duster, eager to do business with some chump's speak hole. There were more tricks up his sleeve, but Bodega was reluctant to even think about them till the time came, in case some sneaky empath was trying to get the drop on him. He took a deep breath and banged on the Quintanium door. Farvarf, said a voice from the other side. Bodega, said Bodega. A moment passed, then the door sprang open.
Bodega,
said Bodega.
It sounds like the guy in Star Wars, the guy that works at Jabba's palace.
Yes.
Bodega.
The one and only. Yeah. And a gigantic Vicarg was in the frame, grinning like a woodle hound. Sweet Groggle, Bodega, he boomed. Come on in, Pard, not seen you for a whiles. Heh, been busy. Where's the birthday Burke? Down in the pit. And I mean, in the pit, said the Vicarg, grinning even more. If his grin extended any further, he was in danger of losing an ear. Bodega headed down the dank corridor into the lobby, then descended a ramp towards the deafening sound of the pulsar sex pit in full flow. Music with so much bass, it was causing the planet's orbit to decay. Booze so strong, the toilets had to be reinforced with giga shields. And women so betitted, Bodega had to wear... Bodega had to wear a quad...
betitted! Jesus! Fuck! Fuck me!
Bodega had to wear a quantanium jockstrap to prevent any inconvenience.
Oh my god.
No man wants to fight with a bone on. Or at least not one that ain't squared away, combat style.
It's a bone on an alien race.
No, a bone on. He headed straight for the bar and ordered a pint of Mutant Ale. No sooner had he started talking than... Bodega! Screamed the man over the music, which the DJ promptly stopped. Silence in the pit. All eyes on Bodega. Pushing through the crowd, a huge Burkean approached. Bodega. Been a while. Not seen you since... maybe 2 weeks ago. Been working. Came back to wish you a happy birthday, Herc Burke. Well, Bodega, back in the pit, said Herc Burke, grinning. People sure were smiling a lot, thought Bodega. Too much. Too much smiling. Ain't no call for all this grinning and smiling. It ain't usual. We were hoping you'd come back. Me, Squiddles, Rhombus, Treg, and, you remember this guy, right? A huge man in a yellow jumpsuit stepped forward. Black skull mask and billowing red cape. Bodega couldn't see his face behind the mask, but he knew he'd be smiling like the rest of these humfunkers. Fluff. It was a setup. The man in yellow. It was none other than Tan Blatchman, Bodega's arch nemesis.
Oh my god. Not Tan
Ship
Blatchman.
Is about to get extremely real in this place, and many, many people were about to be separated from the body parts they held most dear. Bodega intended to get out of this in one piece, and if that meant the end of the Pulsar sex pit and everybody in it, or even within sight of it, so be it. Bodega knew three things had to happen with the next second, or he'd be toast. First, he had to distract every single person in here who was currently pointing a gun at him. The pit was full, so that was maybe 200 people. No problem. He stamped down on the button in the heel of his right boot, and waves of patented Happy Thoughts brain musher poured out of the toe and blasted everybody within 50 meters. Half of them would end up on the floor drooling. The other half would become deeply acquainted with the inside of their own eyelids and spend the next year singing a song about a little flea named Peter. Second, he needed to nail the people unaffected by the brain musher, which was anyone with half an idea about Bodega and what he was capable of, since they would have taken a dose of brain shield. That meant the five morons who'd set this whole thing up. Last gun holstered and no time to draw it, he needed subplans to point to named B, C, and D. Plan B was to employ the grabby grabber in Herc Burke's nuts, which he did to good effect. The grabby grabby shot out of Bodega's left sleeve and clapped on like a grog limpet, sending Herc Burke to his knees, eyes wide and mouth small. Plan C, Squittles, Rhombus, and Treg all fell to the void grenade Bodega had hidden in a molar tooth and spat into the middle of them, congealing their bodies instantly into one homogeneous lump. Finally, Plan D, deal with Blatchman. No doubt he'd got something disgusting up his sleeve, that cape-wearing, jumpsuit-adorned pendejo shitbird. Bodega figured one thing he wasn't ready for was an old-fashioned punch in the kisser. Scram boots propelling him across the room, he connected with Blatchman's jaw with all the fury of a man invited to a birthday party only to be betrayed.
Wait, was the grabby grab still attached?
No, it just shoots out.
Okay.
And thirdly, the entire bar on its ass, one way or another, Bodega did the decent thing and left. Last gun out, he seared a hole in the ceiling and jetpacked gracefully to a height of 200 meters before hovering, setting wide-angle beam on the last gun and raising the entire place and everyone in it to the ground. Farv, he said, pausing for a heartbeat. My tear cycle was parked there. The end. Oh my god.
Shit, so he killed everyone, but he wrecked his bike.
Yeah, forgot about his bike.
Oh, that was fantastic. Shit.
See, the grabby grab, I assumed that it was like attached to something.
You don't want to be left there with a grabby grab.
No, but I thought it was like one of those, you know, those like kid robot arm things with the trigger that like makes it pinch sort of thing, but it was like attached to his pants or something.
I'm pretty sure that he could, if needed, fire it out with like a line attached if he actually had to pull something to him.
Oh, right, and then the line just breaks off,
yeah,
sort of thing.
But he can, yeah. I mean, it's Bodega, you know, he's got a million tricks up his sleeve. One of them is the deployable grabby-grabby that just clamps onto some guy's nuts.
It's pretty nice.
There's 20 minutes at the start about dicks, and we solved, Mike, we solved the micropenis
problem. We solved the micropenis conundrum as well.
Also, wait, we haven't, there is something, hold on a sec.
Oh,
Bodega part quattro. We have Bodega part quattro. If you want, we don't have to do it this week. It's up to you guys.
No, this is the best part.
I wait for this. Yeah.
All right.
You know,
enunciate. Right. Are you ready?
Be careful.
Okay. Enunciate this time. Okay.
I will.
Okay. Good.
Bodega.
Can we have Ray Winston?
No, my voice won't take it.
Okay.
Bodega part quattro. No, we'll do it normally.
Oh, come on.
Bodega part quattro. Clouds of exhaust fumes, the stench of synth oil mixed with coolant, and the musky funk of 1,000 space dock engineers. Bodega choked back the aroma of the Baracchian Quanto hub from high up on a gantry. His Gretham shuttle was parked on the roof, its chameleon stealth field and some fancy flying had made it past the security screens. He rested one hand on his las gun and the other on his groin, which was itching like hell. Damn Spaloopian crotch crabs. 100 meters below.
Not the Spaloopians.
Oh, they're the worst. The busy spaceport on the surface of Quanto 4 looked safe enough. Bodega had been scanning the crowds for an hour now, making sure there wasn't an ambush. That business with the smugglers had drawn some weird heat. Fedpol had been all over him like a case of crotch crabs. He wondered just how high up the remote-controlled vehicle smuggling ring went, but that wasn't his business. What was his business was the stench coming from the toilets on his ship. In orbit, cloaked naturally, its legendary ship, the Disco Volante, waited and, frankly, it reeked. He was pretty sure whatever was causing the noxious stank might even be leaking into space. However badly it ponged, it was still his ship, and at the push of a button on his wrist comp, it would decloak and rocket down to Bodega's position. At the push of another button, the ship would self-destruct, taking anything within 100 clicks with it. Bodega had to make sure he pushed the right button. He didn't know why he'd put the two buttons next to each other, but these things happen. What are you gonna do?
Were they like a different color or anything?
With the spaceport surveillance complete,
okay.
Bodega gave his crotch one more good scratch before he jetpacked down to the main floor. Since he wore no cape, the jetpack worked properly. If he'd been wearing a cape, Scrum knows what would have happened. Once down, he collared a Fedorian engineer and demanded a landing berth for his ship. He called the Disco Volante down from orbit by focusing hard and pressing the correct button. The Fedorians were a squat, ugly collection of what Bodega referred to as nerds. They knew everything there was to know about the inner workings of spaceships and computers and nerd shit like that. Loathsome as they were, Bodega had no choice. He'd studied grown-up things like how to tear a man's throat out and how to field strip a Vitarian squirm beam battle pack, so not useful when it came to fixing a busted mega toilet. The crapper needs some work. Got a stink coming off it worse than Bodega began to explain before the Fedorian interrupted. Its nasal voice cut through Bodega like a las gun through a pack of nerds. Before we even get to the toilets, I really have to question your decision to have only one access door to this vessel. You really should have three. To not even have two is pretty terrible. This thing is already a death trap, and the controls are on the wrong side of the door. They should be on the right, and your gangplank is off angle by about 3 degrees. Bodega grimaced. Fucking nerds, he thought. They entered the ship. I don't smell anything wrong here, said the Fedorian.
It stinks. The toilet. It's broken. Trust me, said Bodega.
It really doesn't, but okay, said the Fedorian, and he made for the toilets. As he entered the main deck of the Disco Volante, he recoiled in horror, pawing at the vid panels and peering into access shafts.
Smell it now, asked Bodega, grinning.
No, it's your setup. My god, you have so many things wrong here! Why is your stealth field not firmware upgraded? Look at this wiring, it's like you don't even care! I have no idea why you would get a ship this expensive if you don't even know how to rig the squig indexer correctly! You must be losing like 1.5% more fuel every time you deorbit! The Fedorian was actually sniggering. He was standing there, aboard the legendary Disco Volante, and laughing at it.
At Bodega.
Bodega's face hardened.
Are you shitting on my ship?
He asked, giving the Fedorian one last chance to climb down from the precipice of a really bad time. The ship is a good one, but it's the owner! My Groggle, you have absolutely no idea what you're doing here, do you? This thing is suboptimal! It actually makes me want to put my head in my hands and maybe make a big post about it in the Fedorian engineering forums! The engineer prattled on, not noticing Bodega unholstering his famous las gun and aiming it squarely at the Fedorian's head.
Pard, you just cussed your planet a spaceport, said Bodega.
As the Disco Volante sped into orbit, the Gretham following on autopilot behind, the explosions from the Barakian Quanto hub could be seen for miles around. Lasgun scorching, torpedo blasts, and even some dents from a fist would be found by investigators in the weeks to come. Bodega found the vault with the toilet anyway. He'd been drunk on bum pincher ale and had just forgotten to flush away a particularly unpleasant crap from the previous night. As his ship entered orbit, he flushed. The ship ejected the toxic poop, which tumbled back down to the planet's surface with a hearty plop. A final reminder for the people of this world,
don't fuck with Bodega.
Oh my god. Oh my god, okay.
Oh, I like the crap in here.
That was a good one. Okay, do you want my storytelling adjunct
go
to
for
the
it,
end?
Go
I think,
for it.
I think what you needed to do was grab the flav by the scruff of his neck. The nerd, sorry, by the scruff of his neck. Get his head down there. Fucking get it in the toilet.
What did you say to Sips last week?
What did I say to Sips?
He tried to correct me and say what you should have done, and you said, you can't tell Pyrian what to do, he's an artist.
Oh, shit. So anyway, do your bodega. Let's fucking get in there. Let's enjoy it.
Yeah. I don't feel like you're in the right frame of mind for a bodega.
Ben said about bodega, he said, thing what I like about Bodega is that it's taking the piss out of all the shit science fiction.
Exactly.
But then it's become its own thing.
Yeah, who knew?
It's grown beyond it to the point where it's a little bit like pandas in World of Warcraft, okay? It started off...
I knew World of Warcraft would fucking come up at some point. Jesus.
It started off being the joke, but now it's coming to a whole expansion.
I haven't been playing it at all recently.
And there's going to be like a Bodega book, and it's going to become a real thing.
But anyway, Bodega, part 5.
This
is very different from other bodegas, this one, okay?
Okay, I mean, in a bad way?
You'll see.
All right.
Scratching the itchy collar of his dull gray uniform, Ensign Crunkett waited impatiently outside Commander Tortola's quarters. He'd made an appointment to see Tortola 3 days ago. How the scriv can the boss man be so busy? They'd been sat in this asteroid belt on silent running for 3 months with no orders that he knew of. What a waste of time. 3 months jammed into every crevice of this fast patrol ship, except for the areas that were mysteriously off-limits. That meant no trips to engineering to hang out with his buddy Looper, definitely no trips to the cargo hold, which was normally a good vape spot. 3 months manning his listening post and hearing nothing. It was space. It was generally pretty flarving quiet. Startling Crunkett, the intercom to Tortola's room barked, "Enter!" and the door hissed open. Crunkett stooped to enter the commander's quarters. They were cramped, yet the designers had still found room to cram a desk in here along with a bed, a bathroom, and a lounge, all in dull official grey. That was the colour of most things around here, official grey. Tortola was sat in his grey uniform and his grey chair behind the grey desk, staring at his computer screen. He made a condescending hand gesture to Crunkett to begin talking. Crunkett cleared his throat. Sir, it's been 3 months. I was due some R&R 2 weeks ago, but because we're stuck here, I missed the birth of my daughter, and I'm thinking... Tortola cut him off with a glance. He read from the screen. Crunkett. Ensign Crunkett. 2 years service on the force. And here you are marching into my quarters to demand leave. We're on a mission. You don't need to know what that mission is, Ensign, but by Groggle, we're on it. You signed over your right to a holiday when you took the oath and put on a badge, said Tortola. A rehearsed dressing down was on its way, Crunkett guessed. Tortola stood up sharply in an attempt to look authoritative, but banged his head on the low ceiling. Pretending this hadn't happened, he continued. lecturing Crunkett about duty and the importance of the Morality Police Division out here in the void of space. How beings could lose their sense of direction and decency, and needed to know that out here in the blackness there was still an organization dedicated to rooting out wrong and bringing justice to the unjust. Just because space is cold and uncaring doesn't mean we have to be. Sir, I've worked law enforcement before. I've done stakeouts before. This feels like a stakeout, but we're staking out an asteroid belt in the arse end of nowhere. Nobody comes here because these rocks are empty. There are no habitable planets. There is no traffic. There's nothing. If I'd known this was going to be the mission, I never would have signed up for it, pleaded Crunkett. I thought we were going to be back in time for my wife's due date. This is the SS Expectation, Ensign, said Tortola, gesturing around him. We're not your usual police cruiser. There's a reason we didn't tell any of you what your mission was. You're getting paid time and a half, so you're being compensated appropriately. I'm not going to ask you to trust me, because this is not about trust. This is about duty. Do your job. Get out of my office, said Tortola coldly. Crunkett left. He wasn't angry. The worker man always got screwed over like this. He was resigned to it. He just wanted to make sure his daughter had better. Crunkett was in the middle of wondering what he was going to do when the red lighting pulsing in the floor and at every comm station told him that the silent alarm had been tripped. He ran to his post, jostling with other members of the crew doing the same. Part of him was nervous. Another part thought, thank Flav, something to do. Tortola was on the bridge in a heartbeat after everyone else. He addressed the crew. Okay, people, it's time to come clean. We've just detected the vessel we were sent to find. We're just one of hundreds of ships just like ours undertaking the same mission all over the galaxy. For 3 months we've been laying in wait like Tredorian trap crabs. And now, finally, we've detected the ship. It's docking at a hidden base on an asteroid in the Borkaba belt, just a few hundred thousand clicks ahead of us. It is vital that we maintain silent running. Ensign Crunkett, go to work. Crunkett slid into his seat and rummaged for his headset. The chatter on the bridge was reaching fever pitch. Everybody was thinking the same thing. Holy shit, something's actually happening. Something's happening, but what? The listening post was incredibly high-tech. He used an almost undetectable array of ultra-fine beams of varying compositions to scan a huge area of space and detect micro-distortions caused by sound waves. In space, of course, there was no sound, but the beam array carried enough different types and layers that even the most well-shielded surface could be probed, and you could listen in to anything pressurized, even a space helmet. And once something was detected, the array could narrow down to that point and listen into anything. The sound of weapons being charged, an ultra-quiet engine, even a conversation, or what Crunkett heard, a man whistling a jaunty tune. He recognized the tune. It was Ode to the Lasgun, a famous war song from Shrovia, the planet of war. Shrovians? Out here in deep space? They normally stuck to their factories and boardrooms, coming up with new and terrible weaponry. Then he heard talking, someone recording a personal log. And when he heard the voice, his blood froze in his veins and he felt tears welling in his eyes. This was the dread fear that consumed all hope in a man. Sir, he mumbled. Crunkett, speak, man. Sir, I think it's Bodega. Tortola stood slowly, steeling himself. Ensign Zither, send the whisper, said Tortola. And the tiny scout vessel of the MPD fired a single subspace particle from its comms array. That single particle would be lost in the background noise of the universe to anyone listening. Impossible to decrypt, impossible to detect. Bodega could not know that the MPD vessel Expectation just sent a one-bit signal. MPD HQ would instantly know meant one thing. Operation Kill Bodega was on.
Bodega. Oh, amazing. So, wow. Okay, couple of things. First of all, I like how it's good shit sci-fi because it's the same shit we're familiar with, yet massively far in the future. It's you know, you've got an ensign and a grumpy guy and like a military boardroom and all that shit and vaping in like a... and do you know what I mean? It's like Ensign Crunkett is totally the Mary Sue of Pyrian Flax. You know, you are. If you put yourself into this universe, you would be.
I wouldn't be Ensign Crunkett.
You're totally Ensign Crunkett. No. There's so much Mary Sueing going on.
I'm Bodega. Like, come on.
No, you're not. You're Ensign Crunkett.
I'm a cold,
with like
hard killer.
Like the hard, dumb by like guy who's like pretty low rank. He's like a bit sick of it. He's had to miss his story.
I wouldn't
his
even
boss.
Be in the police, man. I wouldn't sign up with the Pope. Come on.
100% that. And I like this because by the time something gets to like part five, right, it's got a bit bad, right? And they start doing things like introducing new characters. No, because everyone says, I just wanna have a bodega adventure. But the author's like, oh, I'm a bit sick of writing bodega adventures. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to add some new characters. So he adds Ensign Crunkett and he adds this new guy. And everyone's like, oh, well, it's not the bodega I remember, but at least it's not a bodega.
Bodega wasn't even in this episode, really.
Yeah, and that's what it that's what starts happening when they start getting to like these, you know, later stage sequels and stuff.
As a counterpoint, like, Flax, I thought it was fucking great.
Like a big furry ball sack.
Like two big hairy testicles, one of which has
like,
teeth.
Like gremlins before they become like the gross ones.
Right,
like
right.
The little,
but
yeah,
huge
Furbies.
And furious.
Little
yeah.
Furbies, yeah. A huge, okay. Furious Furby.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. If you can hook me up with all that, that would be awesome.
Okay.
Then I can, yeah. All right, let's see if Bodega part six.
Seis.
Part
six.
Seis.
Seis.
Are you ready?
Drum roll.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Bodega.
Fucking born ready.
Part seis. Huffing and puffing like an old-timey steam engine, Benny the orderly wheeled Bodega out onto the veranda overlooking the grounds of the prison on Pentar 9. He set the brake on the wheelchair and leant against the railings, catching his breath. Pushing this thing around was hell on his back. Phew! Okay, old-timer, here we are. Now, what are we looking for? Said Benny. Bodega wheezed alongside Benny.
There's a star I'm looking for, croaked the ancient convict.
A star for your 300th birthday, huh? Said Benny, kneeling beside him and peering up. He glanced at Bodega, whose face was knotted with concentration.
Can't see nothing, he said finally, before turning his head slowly to Benny. His eyes still had that Bodega sparkle, but he also smelt badly of urine, so it balanced out.
I love this so much
well,
already.
Well, let's head on down, old-timer. They'll be bringing out your cake soon, said Benny, as he stood and began fiddling with the brake lever on the chair. As the wheels pivoted to take them back to the elevator, Bodega took one last glance at the constellations above. There, a bright blue star, brighter than a lasgun beam. It had no place where it was, right in that area of space known as the Dark Rift, a vast area totally devoid of matter. Some said there'd been once thousands of stars and hundreds of worlds in that gap before some insane and ancient mega war had emptied the corner of the galaxy. And now there was a star. Bodega turned to Benny.
Benny, that star there, you see it?
Benny looked. Yeah, I see it, man, I see it.
You know what that star means? Said Bodega, smiling.
Why don't you tell me, pard?
It means something,
said Bodega, looking lost in the thick fog of age. Downstairs at the party, Benny left Bodega at one end of a long table while he went to get the cake. There were no guests. There was a single paper plate and a plastic fork, a napkin, a plastic cup of water. Bodega was held into the wheelchair with metal restraints at his wrists, elbows, knees, ankles, neck, and around his waist. Benny would have to feed him the cake. Benny was great. Benny was a real star.
Real star, said Bodega. Then he froze.
He looked at the plate, at his hands, at the fork. Then he closed his eyes. Benny re-entered the room, just in time for it to explode into a million bright white shards of light, along with Benny. Bodega was lying in what looked like a stasis pod. He was restrained in reality, just like he was in that illusory sim world he'd been stuck in. For how long? How long had he been under? He was as naked as a Quardian. A people known for being naked, and not just naked, but really in your face, think nothing of it, bending down to pick up a penny and giving you an eyeful, naked. He focused hard on that corner of his brain where the implant was, the minute implant that had maybe saved his life. That implant was inserted into his brain a decade ago by his then girlfriend, Majesta. She was a psychic being of nearly limitless power who'd looked into his soul one day and decided that actually it wasn't her, it was him, and they should break up. She took his dog, convincing it telepathically that she would be the better owner. That was the real heartbreaker, thought Bodega.
Oh my god.
What a bitch.
Anyway, the implant was her idea. He remembered her words. Bodega, my love, I've given you a part of my power. I've hidden it in your mind, buried deep in the corner you never use. Just next to your pity and your mercy, you'll find me. If you're ever lost in the darkness, if your mind is not your own, look for me, your bright blue star in the void.
That implant did more than send him a signal. It was also one of the most perfect prison escape packages ever devised. It was the high-tech equivalent of the old file hidden in a cake trick. He needed to crush the implant with his actual brain. He had to use every muscle and sinew in his brain to crush the implant and release its power. Come on, you fucker, pop, thought Bodega. And with titanic effort, pop it did. He saw stars. Then he saw waves of energy all around him, knowing their composition and their purpose, their origin and their future all at once. While the effects of the implant were in full force, he was at one with the universe. He could shape matter, move through it, bend it to his will. He melded right up out of the pod, hanging in the air like some deity. An orderly working the night shift dropped his cup of synth tea and ran out of the room screaming. Bodega didn't have long before the effects of the implant wore off. He could sense his ship about 200 meters below him, and he pivoted in the air and dived straight down through the decks of the station. He realized he was now on. He could sense all the panic. He could see the past and future of every particle and every living person nearby, and he could feel their emotions and their thoughts. It was overwhelming. He focused on the one thing he needed, the Disco Volante. In a moment, he was there, floating in its lounge area. He rematerialized and quickly put on a spare spacesuit. Firing up the engines, he focused one more time and deleted the cargo bay doors from existence. The ship was blown out into space, along with dozens of dock workers. He fired up the engines and plotted a course for somewhere far away, and slammed the hyperspace button with his palm. The Disco Volante hung motionless for a moment, before it became a single streak of light pointing straight into the void. The end.
Bodega. Wow.
Oh,
Part Bodega. Six.
Bodega.
God, that was a glorious Bodega.
That was a really good one.
Thank you. So we missed out. Like I leave all these gaps because I can go back and fill them in later, and also because people like to write all this fan fiction and stuff. So I want to leave all these gaps. Like the trial of Bodega, that has to happen now. What happened at the trial of Bodega? Yeah. How did he end up on Prison Planet? I mean, we know that there was that operation in the last one to capture him, but
yeah,
why didn't
filling in the blanks is fun though.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You can do. You know, you can do like the what they're doing with Star Wars, you know, like
exactly.
The new movie. You can just have yeah. Like little side
it's just
stories.
Like Star Wars. It's just
Bodega
like...
stories.
Boners,
what is it? How do you say it? How are you supposed to say it?
I think...
Buenos Aires. Buenos Aires.
You have to have a little bit of a lisp as well.
Buenos Aires?
And then you have to have a little bit of a silence, and then in your angriest voice, you have to say, puta.
Okay.
Puta.
Good.
Puta. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So, Bodega Part Siete. Would you like to hear it?
Let's do it.
Yeah. Let
Get
me
ready.
Recline. Hang
right.
on.
Yeah. Recline.
Hang on. I'm just gonna. I'm a little
He's
bit tangled up here. Wires. And
press the back of your chair to like you know get it in a more comfortable
nice.
Position.
I've got my legs up and everything.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Ready.
Ready.
Yeah, I guess.
So wait, hang on. What happened last time? Because it's been a little while.
I'll give you a little recap. In
the last one
six,
was the prison.
He was in the mind prison. Yeah, the virtual
right.
mind prison.
That's right. Yeah.
Escaped by channeling that little piece of Majesta that was embedded in his brain. His
right.
former girlfriend, Majesta.
Majesta.
And so he'd used that to turn into a kind of ethereal being like her and had escaped. So now, Bodega, Part Siete. Majesta! Bodega screamed himself awake for the fourth night in a row. He reached his hand slowly to his face and yet again felt tears there. Was he sleep crying? Sweet jumping jub-jub, this was not usual. He dragged the heavy blast-proof sheets back and sat on the edge of the bed, head
blast-proof
in hands.
Blast-proof sheets?
Of course!
Oh my god!
Pondering. When he'd escaped the virtual prison, see episode 6, he'd been forced to deploy the shard of Majesta's power that lay in his mind, which to that point had been dormant, or so he'd assumed. Now it was gone, consumed by his transformation into whatever Majesta was. He probably should have found out the name for her people when they were together, but frankly, that time had been bone central. Every day, all day, just getting busy like Krevians and screaming around the galaxy in the Disco Volante, screwing and shooting stuff sometimes. In short, it fucking owned, and Bodega missed it. He remembered the time they'd taken the crooked casino on Bismuth 11 for all its coin. The time they'd busted those rebel prisoners out of Highsec using just a drinking straw and some chapstick. The time they'd destroyed an entire solar system with the doom egg of the Death Lord, Mr. Pringle. Now that was a long story. Good times. So many good times. And of course, the constant shagging, which was really, really, really good. Just incredible. He was getting a semi just thinking about it. Turns out, Bodega missed Majesta. That little shard of her maybe kept that longing at bay. Maybe she was even kind of with him all this time, but hopefully not when he was on the can or jerking it to Spaloopian porn. He looked at the floor and saw tiny pools of tears reflecting the light from the cockpit. In the reflection of one, he saw something move. Just a teeny tiny little reflection of something to his right. Bodega's reflexes being what they are, i.e. honed to flav, he dived backwards over the bed and was up and ready in a heartbeat, lasgun in hand. His captors had been too worried about the Disco Volante's many booby traps to ever board it and strip it, so all his shit was secure. "I see ya," Bodega shouted, "and I ain't in the mood for this mort crap." "Bodega," said a voice, Majesta's voice. He fell apart, laid out completely, a TKO of the heart. "Baby, baby, I'm hurting," he whimpered. "I know. I'm sorry, my love," she said. He still couldn't see her, just sort of sense her loitering around the edges of his subconscious. And then she was gone. Then suddenly she was back, behind him, to the side, then what felt like a mile away. What the flav? Was she just fooling with his achy breaky heart? "Bodega, I need you to meet me," she said again, her voice distant and ethereal. "Where, baby, where? I got a subscription to Netflarv so we can chill and such like."
Oh my god.
"Come to the planet Stroya 9, at the base of the highest peak on that world, and you'll find my estate. I'll be waiting." The engines of the Disco Volante were at maximum burn before the full stop on the end of that sentence had faded. It was 12 hours to the Stroya system. Bodega did it in 3. He spiraled down through the thick upper atmosphere, his ship roaring across the sky, engines swirling the clouds behind him. High-altitude hoverbirds and strange floating gas bag creatures scrambled clear, but Bodega plowed on, disturbing this tranquil place with the brutality of the warship. He practically collided with the estate in his haste, but then the ship was down. He emergency ejected out of the top and parkoured down across the nose cone. Then he was up and he was running to the gates, vaulting over them with his jetpack, powering with his scram boots to the front door, grabbing the whole flaving thing off its hinges, and knee sliding across the marble floor, stopping at Majesta's feet, his head bowed. Jesus. "Baby, he began as he looked up and saw Majesta holding a tiny baby swaddled in a Mimlock silk blanket. He stood slowly, removing his hat. "What's this little feller's name?" he asked gently. "I named him after his father," said Majesta, smiling. "Why, hello there, little Bodega Jr.," said Bodega, smiling. He felt something in his heart go twang, like an old guitar string that badly needed tuning. This was an unfamiliar sensation. It was the pure love of a parent for their child. He looked at Majesta, but her expression was strange. Her perfect brow knotted, her lips parted. "No, Bodega, after his father," she said. "This is Tan Blatchman Jr." And with that sentence, Bodega's universe imploded. The end.
Oh my god.
Oh my god. Hey.
Oh no.
So, two things, okay? Yeah. In this world of crazy sort of like lingo for things.
Right.
Jerking it, I felt, could have been something else. You know, like jerking it. Like, you know, what about like thwarving it or something, you know?
Yeah, but
like
you wouldn't
instead
know what that meant. You know what jerking it means. Like, there are some things that never change. Even when you're out in the galaxy and everything's all crazy and there's all kinds of weird animals and stuff, swear words might change, just like they do in real life and stuff. But jerking it is jerking it. That's it. That ain't never gonna change.
Also, I'm a little bit sort of with the Majesta shard, okay?
Yeah.
I feel like it's in Bodega.
It was.
It was.
Yeah.
Maybe corrupting him a little bit while it's in there. And man, I am not on board for a story of corruption and fell, okay?
What I'm do you mean saying. Corruption? He ain't corrupted.
Okay, good. Let's just make, I just want to be clear that like,
what, you think Majesta's, the implant would have made him evil?
No, not evil, just somehow corrupted him to do things that maybe he wouldn't have done.
It was just an escape, it was a prison escape kit embedded in his brain, remember?
Okay, okay.
It's like,
so that
when
no,
when
I know
he
that's what he
it.
Used it for, but I just wanted to make sure that like,
fear not.
It was like a special one-off
fear not.
You know,
okay.
It was a one-shot, it was a one-shot escape plan.
Like the file in the carrot cake.
Exactly. It was like that.
Yeah. Exactly. Man, P-Flex, this was emotionally charged.
It was really good.
It felt like I was reading a little bit of a sexy girl
porn.
Oh
yeah, you know it.
Mills and Boone, you know, the classic thing that girls love to read about love and romance.
I feel like the
romance,
character development is really coming together. Like, big time.
Yeah. Man, hearing him do, like, speak a bit more is also
he doesn't talk much.
No.
Loved it. Yeah. Was transfixed the whole time. Oh, that good. Was. I think you've outdone yourself.
Oh,
actually,
thank you,
P-Flex. This was
one of the better ones.
One of the best. I've got no gripes. Oh, I loved it, start to finish.
Wow, good.
Yeah. You know,
got
it's
a
good.
Big old raging boner now.
Wow,
loving it.
Nice.
Yeah, I think. I think it's time to end the episode then, in that case, because I've got to deal with this.
It's got a lot of emotions to sift through now.
All right, guys, can we stop for about 15 minutes? Yep, see you in a bit. Yep.
I only need like 2 minutes.
Guys, let's go. I spilled coke all over my pants. I've just got to go wipe it.
We lived in a broken world. It was a broken world. And everything was closed. Shit was closed all the fucking time. Nowadays, everything's open.
You'd turn up, you'd be like, I need to get something. You go to the store, it's closed down?
Yeah,
what?
Closed.
When? Yeah, she's gone.
That actually did happen a lot, Maybe that was just the ravages of time, though.
Maybe.
That was like, oh, it was 10 years since I visited this town.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Holy shit. So do we have a bodega?
Bodega part ocho.
Oh, we do.
Ocho.
Yeah, we do.
I like that.
Yeah. Are you ready?
What's nine for nientes? Nino. Part
so nine-o. Translate from English.
Right.
Nueve.
There is a. Nueve. I just looked up bodega t-shirt. You actually have to type in bodega t-shirt.
Yep.
Yogscast. Okay, because otherwise you get loads of others. Yeah, like there's Bodega Bay place. Apparently that's a big place.
Get
I don't know.
I love it. I'm very very happy with it. And if that's you want to just send us cash money, please do that. That's fine. Just send
hell yeah, in an envelope
bullion,
all crinkled up.
Yeah.
Fucking.
Me and Sips
you,
are fine,
may have put your
P-Flex
shopping list
got
on
like
it.
Five kids and like your cousins and brothers and grands and everything, and you know
I need
it's a
help,
mess.
Folks. I need help.
Everyone's begging for cash. You know, have to stop writing letters to people because you can't afford the phone.
Oh dear, yeah.
Your dear mom Floppy, she hasn't had heat for a year. You desperately need some money.
Biff
turn
and
that
have
heat
nothing.
Back on.
They have nothing.
Biff
Biff
and
has
Chip
a
are starving.
Pot. Chip has a mop. That
That's
is
it.
All.
Now read it. It's a weird test tomorrow.
Okay. Bodega.
Let's go.
Part ocho. When Bodega got really upset, there were three likely outcomes. Option one, go blow up the nearest big thing. Could be a pirate base, could be a veterans hospital. Didn't matter. Something is getting vaporized. Generally speaking, he went after baddies, like a veterans hospital for soldiers that had become veterans by slaughtering innocent people. Imagine a retirement home for space Nazis. It's still a veterans hospital, and it's still full of the shuffling elderly, but come on, flav those guys. Option two, get blind drunk and crash his ship into something large. Then hop out, argue about quantum insurance with whichever moron confronted him, and then blow the whole place up. Option three, sit on a rock. Bodega was sat on a rock. The universe breathed a collective sigh of relief. The rock sitting option was the one reserved for when Bodega wasn't just upset in a regular way, but in a really baffling how the flav did that happen way. For when he needed time to get his head around the problem. This rock was on a tiny planetoid called Mu in the mostly uncharted BV-332 Delta system. Bodega liked this spot because the view was so insane it took his mind off his troubles. And it also had a really bizarre atmosphere that was alcoholic, around 6% proof. You could just sit here and breathe and get nicely loaded and check out the overhead vista of four galaxies colliding. The sky on the dark side of BV-332 Delta Mu was ablaze with billions of stars battling each other for supremacy and generally exploding or dragging each other's guts all over the darn sky. This was what gravity was designed to do. Pull things to shreds, take the beautiful and render it down to its component atoms. It took the free and the liberated and made them its slave. Bodega could feel the atoms of his own body and hoped that one day soon someone would spread them around the galaxy so he couldn't feel this pain anymore. It was his brain atoms that were currently giving him the most pain. He toyed with his las gun, running a finger over the muzzle brake at the end of the barrel. Would he even feel it? He tossed the las gun to one side. Life went on. Surely life went on. Even when your gal has partnered up with one of the largest anuses in the known universe. Tan flarving Blatchman. First of all, how the scriv had that Mongol clogger not died at the Pulsar Sex Pit self-defense massacre? This was Blatchman we're talking about, and he is a canny bastard, but still, that place was leveled fairly convincingly. Bodega was glad Blatchman was alive. It meant he could kill him, and properly this time, by hand, one hand, and by the balls. Killing a man with one hand and applying lethal force via the balls only was something Bodega reserved for real, actual bastards like Blatchman. He called the technique the way of the exploding plums. It was taught only in the most prestigious dojos by the most adept grand masters of hand-to-groin combat. He'd taken out a patent and everything. Every time someone used the way of the exploding plums technique, he got a small royalty payment. It was a nice little earner. Just as he was flexing his right hand and grinning in anticipation at feeling Tan Blatchman's naked scrotum nestled in his palm, two things occurred to him. Firstly, that was the single most homoerotic thought Bodega had ever had. And secondly, that it might really upset Majesta if he were to do this. These were followed by a third quick follow-up thought, which was, flav that bitch. He couldn't bring himself to hurt her directly, but flav her and flav that mewling Blatchmanite she called a child. Hey mister, something wrong? Asked a small voice to his left. Bodega turned slowly to see a small pink creature shaped, and if this wasn't proof of a crazy god at the heart of all things, then nothing was like a dildo. It was a dildonian. A people shunned through necessity by
dildonian.
A people shunned through necessity by all vagina-having life forms. The Dildonians were one of the few races denied any kind of place in the Universal Accord. No seat at a high table, no presence on any council. They were one of the forgotten peoples, and it had to be that way, for their own protection, for one thing. What kind of sex slaves would people turn them into? And what kind of conversation would any vagina-having species be able to carry on with a talking dildo?
Howdy, pard. Not seen one of you little fellers in a while, sighed Bodega.
Heh, nothing new there. I spend most of my time hanging out around here in my tiny hermit cave. You know how it is, of course. Apparently, we really, really resemble something called a dildo to most people in the universe, rambled the creature. And stranger still, we even call ourselves Dildonians.
Yep, probably one of them infinite universe things, said Bodega, rubbing his stubble.
You thinking of trying the hermit business? Chirped the Dildonian. It ain't a fun one, but it's kind of satisfying to make it on your own.
I think on my own is something I'm gonna be for the foreseeable, said Bodega, squinting at the horizon. But I ain't the hermit kind. Too restless.
The small creature looked sheepish, or as sheepish as a 12-inch erect phallus can.
Fucking dildo.
That's fucking amazing. It cleared its throat. Do you have a vagina? It asked.
No, friend. I'm one of them dick-havers, smiled Bodega.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm gonna go back to my cave.
That's gonna be my icebreaker.
Do you have a vagina?
Nice chatting to you. Good luck, said the Dildonian. Bodega touched the brim of his hat and nodded once. Scriv, things could be worse. He turned his head up once more to the cluster flav of stars in the slow death churn and took a good hard tug on his mega vape. He wasn't going to take revenge on Majesta. He would kill Blatchman if the opportunity arose, but if he chased him down and killed him, it'd be no better than smashing galaxies together. All that would be left would be a colossal black hole. Bodega settled on something else. He decided right then that he was going to start a small business. The end.
Okay.
Nice.
Oh, man. I can't wait to find out what that is. That cameo from that guy. Oh, my God. That was just amazing. Loved it.
Fucking
Dildonians.
Can we
get a Dildonian t-shirt, do you think? Probably not.
I think on the Dildonian t-shirt, it should be a picture of a Dildonian looking very happy and then with the speech bubble that says, do you have a vagina?
That should be the new thing rather than I have a small dick. It should be
Do you have a vagina? It has to be a bit sheepish, so you have to be do you have a vagina?
Yeah, I like that.
Hey, who wants to hear what? Bodega Part Nueve?
Oh, man.
Oh, cool.
I do, actually.
If you don't if you don't want to, that's fine. But if you'd like to.
Do you hear special? Is it Christmas special?
No, it's not. It's not themed in any way.
Fuck, I do want to say.
Does Bodega have any New Year's resolutions himself?
Fuck no, dude.
No.
I'm a little bit sick of the Sherlock and Doctor Who and all these things being done as like Christmas sort of specials now. I'm a little bit...
Yeah, it sucks.
And then two people died in EastEnders over the Christmas break as well. Did you hear about
that? Was Phil Mitchell one of them?
No. He's due to die soon, apparently, but no. Gotta be big.
They have to keep upping themselves, though, too, right? They have to be like, okay, this has to be more explosive than last time. We have to kill more people. It has to be more dramatic. It's like Game of Thrones, right? They have to, every season, they have to up the body count. So they're like,
we've detected the next nuclear warhead underneath Walford. Where do we go?
It didn't survive the Y2K.
Y2K,
it's got a Y2K bug in it. Phil Mitchell reveals I've done a bit of Fortran programming in my time.
Rolls back.
Phil Mitchell's a Fortran consultant.
Oh, don't worry.
From the 80s.
Phil, save us. Hold on, love. I'm debugging. Fucking hell.
I'm debugging. Oh, fuck.
Shit. Anyway, let's do Bodega and let's get out of here.
Bodega Part Nueve. All right. Now, if you remember, in Part Ocho, he was on the planet with the Dildonian. And at the end of that episode, he decided he was going to start a small business. Okay, so that's the pitch for Part Nueve. A small red light blinked on, and the intercom atop the desk.
Wait, hang on. You got to do the intro, though. You got to go, Bodega.
Sorry.
Bodega, Part Nueve.
A small red light blinked on, and the intercom atop the desk of Sheila Bam barked,
Forms! Infernal thing! What in the crackle bzz, Flarf!
From the next room, a voice shouted, Sheila, could you get me a pile of them R580V Cronkite text forms, please? Sheila smiled and rose, shuffling towards the filing cabinets in the corner. She quickly located the R580Vs and took them through to Bodega's office. Here you are, darling, she said, setting them on his cluttered desk.
Shoot, I can't get this gork damn intercom to do a flarvin' thing. I'll just set the hollering if and I need you next time, said Bodega, scowling at the small smoking intercom unit, a thin zip blade embedded in its face.
He'd wanted one of these since it seemed like a thing people had in offices. It made the office look more office.
It's very 80s.
Very 80s. It was garbage. Total waste of Skrulls. Sheila smiled and turned to leave. Working for Bodega was challenging. He loved technology, but also hated it. He was lovable, but also a terrifying and heavily armed killer on the run from the feds. But it was steady pay and had good dental coverage, so Sheila was happy. Her teeth were a mess. As she was leaving his office, she noticed Bodega had written some names on a whiteboard on the wall. You got the numbers for all that lot, or do you need me to get the Galactic Interlocatron out? Most of these fellas ain't had contact details for years. Gonna need the old GI for this one, yep, said Bodega, leaning back in his chair and putting his feet up. And how about some scoffy? Scoffy was short for Space Coffee, a name so stupid even Bodega balked at using it. But Scoffy was great. He felt like a real office person when he put his feet up on his desk and asked for his secretary to get him a cup of Scoffy. She knew how he took it too. Scream and two scruggers. The ideal color for a cup of coffee was, in Bodega's opinion, perfect tan.
Nice.
And to ensure Sheila knew this exact shade, he'd taped a photo of the ideal cup of scoffee next to the scoffee machine. He also had a tiny surveillance camera that fed straight into his computer terminal so he could watch her while she brewed it, to ensure there was no poisoning, mussing, nor fooling going on with his beverage.
Right. Nice.
About 10 minutes later, just as the scoffee was kicking in, a notification popped up on Bodega's screen. Sheila performance review, it said. Flarv. Time to let Sheila know how she was doing and such. This was what management was all about, he guessed. Sheila, he shouted. A moment later, she entered his office. Sit your butt down, Sheila, said Bodega, trying to look kind of official. There was a long silence. You're doing great. Now get me a scoffy, he said. She smiled, and left his office. Bodega clicked complete on the pop-up, and that was that. Easy. Bodega, I've got some contact information for those people on your list, shouted Sheila. Send it through, he bellowed. Okay, she hollered. In it came, reams of information about the 9 people on Bodega's get list. Gork bless the Interlocatron. The Galactic Interlocatron was a vast listening device and database. It grabbed every unscrambled signal, unencrypted message, phone conversation, or any other form of communication and stored it. Even casual real-life person-to-person chats in a public place were likely to be overheard by some kind of listening device and duly recorded in the GI database. Of course, access to anyone other than super high-level federal types was forbidden, but Bodega had lived his life by the simple credo, forbidden is for Bodega. Now he needed to get in contact with those bastards and find out if they were interested in his project. They would be. After all, how could they turn this down? The chance to form the 10 most bastardy bastards into one mess of murder and carnage and just do shit. Fluff. That was the problem. He knew they had to have a big idea beyond just do shit, but it wasn't coming to him. How could he go out and pitch do shit to 9 people like him? It needed a hook. Sheila, could you come in here? Sheila, of course, obliged. Sheila, what in the floor is this all about to you? What's the point of it all? Asked Bodega, tipping his hat back so he could see her face real good. Well, you just have to try to do right by people around you and try not to leave behind more of a mess than already was there when you arrived. And just enjoy life, she said sweetly. No, I mean, well, we ain't getting those folks together to throw a darn baby shower or help some old people fix their plumbing. We're up to no good, see, he said. Well, honestly, I thought you were planning on overthrowing the Federation, and I just thought, well, why not? That's a pretty tall order, missy. I ain't one for rebel causes. I just want folks to leave me alone, said Bodega. Well, what if it was a sort of Bodega-style federation, like your own version, she said. Bodega contemplated this idea. Too much paperwork, he said, eyeballing the already mountainous pile in his in-tray and imagining that scaled up to running a galaxy. No, I just meant the shooting part, she said. Bodega grinned. Now that I can get aboard with, missy, said Bodega, turning his chair towards the viewport and gazing out at the asteroid field they were concealed in. Yeah, this could work. His own version of the Federal Morality Police Division, the humfunkers who'd locked him up in that mindfuck of a prison a few months back. A group of people who folks could turn to for justice when those who were meant to be just were being unjust or just kinda dicks. I'll call it Bodega's Space Rescue Force of People He Knows. Sheila winced. We'll brainstorm it, Sheila, all right? The end.
I like the vibe, the whole 80s small
Bodega's
business.
Bodega's idea of what a business would be like.
Yeah,
I like it a lot.
It is. It's a very 80s vibe to Bodega's business ideas.
It's a little bit noir, isn't it? So a little bit of a dirty detective's office.
But not so much a detective, but more a Bodega's space force of people he kind of knows.
I feel like this episode has been a very important bridging episode.
It is
like,
an important bridging
episode. I think people might listen to it and be like, that was a really bad episode, but... Similar to The Empire Strikes Back, years later they'll look back and they'll realize how important
it was
the episode actually
was.
They'll
realize
to build up the rest of the story.
And how important all of those little details were. You know,
I just wanted to see Bodega in an office. That was it.
No, I think it was good, man. It was just as good as all the other ones.
You said it was a bad episode.
No, I think that I don't personally think it was bad.
I think that
people maybe now... expect a lot of action every episode.
Oh, no, you can't have
stuff,
action
you know
every
I mean?
Episode.
No,
action
that's what I'm
every
saying.
Episode,
I'm saying the pacing
boring.
Is perfect for me.
You got to slow it down.
I like how it slowly unfolds.
Because now he needs to go out into the galaxy and make contact with the baddest bunch of bastards you've ever met. None of them will be as good a shot, obviously, but they all have skills.
Sometimes you need an episode to lay out the framework of the rest of the journey, right?
And now I've got to come up with 9 other characters that are kind of like Bodega, but each have their own set of skills. That is going to be fun. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, that's going to be great. I mean, like the cocaine in Colombia just sort of, by the end of the 90s, is just like...
It's ridiculous, right?
You love that whole thing. That's a big... You're big into
it's
that.
Completely sort of... They got it, and then sort of
you're
like all the cocaine production...
The gangsters,
moves to
the mafia, the family,
all that
stuff. That's your jam. All right, let's do Bodega and let's get it out of here.
Because I'm a gangster IRL, that's why.
Okay, are you ready?
Yeah.
Real gangster.
Bodega, part 10. In the palace of the self-appointed King Wabu, there was a small cupboard beneath a grand staircase. Inside that cupboard, a bulky humanoid form stood silent and still. It was sleek, like a Horvathian air leopard. Its outer skin was dark charcoal grey, and so matte it seemed to reflect almost no light at all. Its head was a simple, slightly tapered oblong with no protuberances or markings, a monolith of efficiency housing some of the most advanced sensors ever created by the Shrovian labs. Its body looked like someone had taken a human being and replaced the limbs with bits of old weaponry. The arms surely belonged to some battlecruiser turret or shoulder-mounted blast cannon. Its legs seemed to be the bones of some ancient war machine found dormant on a dusty world. Its torso looked like hell had carved it from the corpse of a fallen angel. It bore no markings, but it bore grudges. It wasn't so much programmed as evolved. A droid this complex wasn't something you simply hacked together. It had to be created and then nurtured as it devised its own stratagems and tactics. That evolution and growth came at a human cost. It had not only learnt to kill and destroy, it had learnt too who its true enemies were, and it could hate people. Its current situation was its least favourite according to its database, and it wanted revenge on the person responsible, who also happened to be the number one result in its search revenging. That person was King Wabu. Its sensors detected motion outside the cupboard. No doubt Wabu come to gloat again. The door opened, and the droid heard a familiar voice.
Howdy, pard. You still the Varu I knew, it said.
Processing. Human. Bodega. Bodega, it said. What is purpose of visit?
Dang, they still got you talking like that, huh? Said Bodega.
Affirmative, said Varu.
Well, pard, when I knew you, you were Varu. Those letters still stand for what they used to?
Asked Bodega, tilting his hat back and leaning on the door jamb.
Affirmative, said Varu.
Let's bust you out of here and get to work, said Bodega, smiling.
He rested his hands on his gun belt.
There is a problem, began Varu.
Wabu, that fat old mork beast ain't any kind of problem, I assure you, Bodega said, turning
and revealing what lay on the ground behind him. Wabu, hogtied and gagged. The king, as he called himself, shrunk in horror at the sight of Varu advancing on him.
Where is my Tamagotchi? It asked.
said Wabu. Varu took hold of one of the king's pinkies and began crushing it delicately between its super-powered fingers. Said Wabu with more urgency.
Hold up, said Bodega. What in the world is a Tamagotchi?
Ancient toy from old Earth. Varu had last one in existence. Had kept alive for centuries. Wabu stole,
said Varu, getting more angry and flattening Wabu's finger completely. Screamed Wabu, nodding towards his belt with the only motive part of him. Varu examined the king's belt and found a small pouch containing the precious Tamagotchi, its casing worn down almost to nothing, but its tiny screen and artificial creature still visible. But the tiny creature, instead of being alive and happy, was now simply a tombstone. Varu said nothing for a long time. Wabu began crying. Tears ran down his face and pooled on the grand marble floor. He looked up at his fabulous ceiling and wept. It was the last time he would get to see the subtlety in its design, the grandiose sweep of its arches and buttresses. Varu rose slowly and turned to Bodega.
My son is dead!
And a single oily tear pooled at a point on its monolithic face. An oily tear! Pooled at a point on its monolithic face where Bodega assumed its eyes would be and slithered down, plinking off the armor of its chest. Bodega considered the droid. He pulled down his hat, took a big old hit off his mega vape and sighed.
Does Varu still stand for Very Angry Robot Unit? He asked.
Varu turned to him.
You know it, bitch, said Varu,
before stamping on Wabu's head with the force of a rotting grunk. The royal skull exploded, and Varu turned calmly to Bodega, its head cocked slightly to the side. Bodega looked and saw what it was indicating, a small red oval on its neck.
Wabu, fingerprint, it said,
and Bodega understood. He hacked off Wabu's index finger and held it to the red oval.
Ah, that's better, said Varu. That voice control unit made Wabu laugh. He held me hostage here, humiliating me, forcing me to toil as a simple servant. Over my head, the constant threat that he would kill my Tamagotchi. Now that it's dead and Wabu is dead, I am free. But my sadness circuits are completely overloaded. I will never kill again, said Varu.
Flarv! Well, what if we get you another Tamagotchi, said Bodega.
Or you could just reboot me, said Varu.
Cool, said Bodega, and they got the Disco Volante and flew away. The end.
Oh, man. What an episode. Fucking the oily tear as well. Oh. The icing on the cake.
This is it. This is how he starts forming the crack team.
Recruit the crack team of ne'er-do-wells.
Yeah.
Nice. Fucking
I think of it
man.
A little bit like Ocean's, you know, Ocean's films, you know, where he has to get together like all of the old contacts.
The best of the best.
That's always my favorite. That's always my favorite part of those movies.
Job.
Yeah. And there's always like the crazy guy who's good at bombs.
Yeah, like, bomb guy.
Has anybody seen Gary? He's just like
blowing something up.
He blows up a bank or something. Yeah.
There's some hacking guy. There's a beautiful woman. There's all those kind of people in those things. So I'm gonna come up with eight more people that are kind of messed up. So a Tamagotchi obsessed robot is the first one. I thought that was kind of.
But he's rebooted now, so is he going to forget about the Tamagotchi?
No,
completely?
But his sadness circuits will reset, so he'll be okay.
Sadness, nice. Okay. Nice.
I think his voice should stay as the robo voice. You like that a lot more?
Yeah, I like the robo voice.
It's a little too much. I did prefer it, but I thought, do I want to do this stupid voice every time Varu says something?
Yeah, yeah. You killed my son. She's just dead. Yeah, it's crazy. She was only like 16 years old. It was nuts.
Well, to lighten it, there's a teacher at my old school now whose name is Cornelius Swanky.
He came back from the grave.
That is a hell of a name. Cornelius Swanky.
Was that a Deadpool thing? Like,
no, just... there's a thing called Rate My Teachers. Capri Gorbalchuk. That's her name. Capri Gorbalchuk.
What are you saying? Stop jabbering.
These are names.
It's a name. Are these not names even of your Deadpool teachers? Either. They're just like... legit names.
Three of these teachers there were kids at my school when I was there, and now they're teachers there. Mr. Marshy Boo. These aren't real names.
They can't.
Mr. Marshy Boo?
Yeah.
Isn't that like a sex name, nickname for someone?
I don't know.
Mr. Marshy Boo, I'm ready.
Bring the model of the Eiffel Tower with you. Bring that slab of concrete and your bike in here. I'm ready for you, Mr. Marshy Boo.
Okay.
Think it's time to put a bookend on this one. Okay. Do we have a bodega this week?
We do, yeah, if you'd like it.
Okay.
I'd like to, first of all, apologize for my Scottish accent in advance of this
what?
One.
No, can no, we get, before remember, we start the bodega, can I get just a consensus or a reading?
Yeah.
I saw Rogue One and liked it. Any thoughts?
Yeah, I enjoyed it. Yeah, it was all right. Yeah? Yeah.
Lewis?
Yeah.
It was fine.
It was fine. Okay. Yeah. All right.
I enjoyed it.
Okay. Bodega. Part 11.
Fuck.
Baru, you better come up here, said Bodega, clicking the intercom off. He sat stiffly in his seat on the bridge of the Disco Volante, drumming his fingers on the chrome tabletop at the captain's station. A door hissed open and Varu stooped to enter, his metallic hands clasping the door jamb. Are we nearly there? Asked the droid.
Yep, said Bodega, indicating the viewport. There it is, Tartania.
A vast tartan sphere filled the screen, its ice caps extending almost to the equator of the world, but the bold tartan colors of the continent still glared through with menace.
Madre de Dios, whispered Varu.
Its head grew slightly paler, and Bodega thought he noticed a slight tremor in one of its legs.
Okay, Pard, let's suit up. If we want to get where we're going in one piece, we better look the part.
A few hours later, Bodega and Varu exited the Disco Volante and strolled down the ramp into the spaceport. The bitter wind tore into them and lashing rain stung their faces, but the overwhelming stench of deep-fried food was the real acclimatizer.
My lord, said Bodega, retching. Stay strong, said Varu, clasping Bodega's upper forearm.
What?
What about the voice chip, remember?
No, you said you wanted him back the other way, so
I know
back the other
I wanted
way.
Him back, but there's no story to explain why he's back.
You don't need it. You don't need it.
Bodega just turned it off. He preferred the old one, all right?
Okay.
It's just an interstitial.
Enough.
Okay.
Sorry. I like how Sips is like leaning back in like a dad armchair.
Hey, shut up a minute.
This is
Wait.
How I like to enjoy my okay. bodega.
Wait,
jeez.
You fucked up. You forgot to send his voice chip back. All right, can we continue?
Oh my God, do you know how he's getting Larry? He's getting like an entitled fanboy, isn't
he?
He's
just...
like, this is like someone in the cinema who's like, oh, no, that's not how he stands in the Star Wars.
Exactly. All right, so, stay strong, said Varu, clasping Bodega's forearm. Varu's voice chip unit had been replaced by Bodega some weeks before. I'll add that in.
Okay,
Bodega
good.
Nodded and puffed out his chest, but the biting cold made him feel tiny and helpless, and he noted that however hard he tried, he shrank and cowered in the face of the brutal climate. What didn't help was that he was wearing nothing more than a t-shirt and a pair of jeans, but a coat was a death sentence on Tartania, and with these winds, a hat was impossible. Bodega turned to one of the station hands milling about, drinking a can of spatial brew.
Ori,
he said, the most friendly and formal greeting possible on this world.
Ori, pal, what's going on, said the man. Looking for a friend of mine. Name a Big Rab, said Bodega.
I will fucking aid these after someone. I didn't care about a Big Rab. Now get to fuck, said the man.
His ginger hair and beard frozen solid with ice. Bodega realized he had no idea where Big Rabby was, and that nobody on Tartania would ever help. Their culture forbade friendliness of any kind. After meandering around the major cities of Glasgow and then Edinburgh for a few days, Bodega and Varu were exhausted. They'd been in countless fights and had the injuries to show for it. Baru's left arm hung loosely at his side after a pack of wild Neds had cornered him and Bodega and beaten them senseless. The fighting skills of the Tartanians were undisputably the best in the galaxy, but when combined with their daily ration of 15 cans of spatial brew, they also became irascible. Every cab driver, shop worker, and elderly person they'd spoken to had responded with violence, and the two interlopers were so cold they could barely think. Bodega, it's hopeless, said Varu.
There's one place we haven't tried yet, Parge, said Bodega wearily.
No, please, Varu begs you, said Varu, looking as anxious as a faceless droid could.
We're going to the meanest, roughest place in the sector. We're going Dune the Pub, said Bodega,
squinting up and taking one last look at the cold star of Titania, which itself almost seemed to be scowling at them. The pub, the only one left in Titania thanks to the world's shattered economy and tendency towards violence. All the others had been burnt to the ground or shut down thanks to the death at 23 due to heart disease of all but a handful of Titanians, making them unsustainable as businesses. But one had persisted, run by the fearsome Mad Donald. So terrifying a combatant was he that even the people of Titania didn't mess with Mad Donald. The pub was the one place a man like Big Rab could hide out indefinitely from any lawman or assassin. Bodega was neither, but he was something worse in the eyes of the Titanians, a southerner. There was no south in Titania. The poles of the planet were aligned in such a way that only north existed. Taking a cab into the center of Glesgay, Bodega and Varu approached the pub with intense trepidation.
Be ready to run, hissed Bodega, shivering so badly he felt he might dislocate something.
The door to the pub was almost off its hinges, and every window was boarded up. As they entered, the entire place went as quiet as death. Seated on small stools were the biggest, ugliest, meanest collection of pure scum imaginable. No inch of flesh went untattooed. No face held a morsel of kindness. Blood stained the carpet, and teeth were strewn about like party favors. Bodega steeled himself and approached the bar, slapping down his money and making sure to use coins instead of fancy banknotes, which would be seen as an attempt to show off wealth. Ori, two spatial brews, pal, said Bodega. Behind the bar was Mad Don himself. He stared into Bodega's soul for what felt like weeks, but was in fact just 15 minutes. Bodega knew not to move, not to break into a sweat or blink. He must maintain eye contact with Mad Don and show no fear. Mad Don finally moved, slowly pouring the drinks and taking the money, baring his teeth as he did so. Bodega was now stuck. If he stayed at the bar, there was every chance one of the other patrons would approach and order a drink of their own. And if a single molecule of that drink was spilled, Bodega and Varu would be torn limb from limb. It was too risky to stay where they were. But turning back around and facing the stares of the Tartanian braves assembled here was a bridge too far. Yet they had to find a seat. Too late.
Yous two bastards are the bar, said a voice behind them. Hold on a minute. I can yous.
Bodega's blood ran cold. Mustering every bit of strength he had left, he turned towards the speaker.
All right, said Bodega, still the only Titanian he knew. Dry your eyes, you big fanny, you look like you're gonna piss yourself, said the voice, still emanating from some darkened corner near the back of the pub.
A figure approached Bodega, a man so large and heavily bearded, so ginger, that Bodega at first mistook him for a hairy boulder rolling their way.
It's okay, Don, these cunts are with me, said the man, slapping Bodega on the shoulder and draining his pint. Three more bevies, pal, he said to Don, collecting the drinks and heading back to his table, Bodega and Varu trailing after him like ducklings clinging to their mother.
So what's going on, said Rab.
Bodega explained the plan and Rab smiled.
We're sort of like the anti-polis, he asked.
Kinda. We just do shit, adventures and such, make money, help out folks that don't get help from the law, said Bodega,
trying to stay on top of the potent brew he was forced to consume at such a rate he assumed Rab was trying to use the alcohol to preserve his body for medical science.
I'm in. Now let's get rambling, you pair of mincing ball bags.
After just a handful of bloody skirmishes, they returned to the Disco Volante, which was scrawled with graffiti and covered in streaks of human feces. Someone had tried to deep fry one of its wings, but had given up eating it after just a few bites. Oh. They climbed aboard, and Bodega breathed a sigh of relief. Varu walked silently past Rab and Bodega and collapsed face first onto the deck of the cargo bay, powering down.
Ah, he'll be fine, said Rab, swaying slightly. No, let's get the fuck out of here.
Bodega had never been so glad to leave a planet in his life. They had done it. They had survived a trip to Titania, and they now knew never, ever, ever to return.
The end.
Oh my god, that was glorious.
That was a good one. That the Scottish accent was really good too.
Oh god, it was so good. There were so many really nice references.
So you're assembling the cast of Overwatch without realizing it, because now so far you've got Bastion on board.
Oh, true.
You've got Torbjorn now. You've just acquired.
Well, and, he's not Scottish though.
And of course you've got McCree as well in Bodega.
Wait, Torbjorn is tiny and not Scottish.
He's fat and he's ginger bearded and he's got the same accent. So
I don't play much Overwatch. I didn't realize it had that kind of effect on me, but I do watch a lot of Overwatch porn, as we found out last week.
Me too. Yes, I think that's what it is. Oh my god, well, that was absolutely
next week they'll get a big gorilla or something. I don't know, just thinking off the top of my head here.
Yeah, that would work, yeah.